intuition, but some things you just don't question. Like in your eyes, I see my future in an instant, and there it goes. I think I found my best friend. I know that it might sound more than a little crazy, but I believe I knew I loved you before I met you. I think I dreamed you into life. I knew I loved you before I met you. I have been waiting all my life.
Hi everybody, this is Dr. Ed Park and Recharge Biomedical, and we're doing a show today on female fertility. This first slide, or intro slide, shows what the problem is. As we get from the 20s, you start to become less fertile. Once you hit the magic 40, you only have about a third of a chance of even getting pregnant, and of course the risk of miscarriage goes up. Concomitant with this is the other curve, which is the rate of infertility. So your curves are crossing there at 40. Anyway, everyone knows that it's harder to get pregnant as we get older, but not everyone understands why, so that's what we're going to talk about. Really, people talk a lot about, you know, when the best time to get pregnant is. Actually, it's probably a teenager. Probably in terms of anthropology and evolution, we were supposed to get pregnant around 14, 15, but because of modern life and the exigencies of that, people delay. They have birth control, there's premarital sex, and there are career considerations. So in all the developed countries, of course, the population rate is negative. Even in China, I think they've re-examined the single child policy. So I had an advisor who was the head of the population council, Dr. Alan Rosenfield, and he always used to talk about the Malthusian concerns about overpopulation. In point of fact, people are very selfish, and so in developed countries, you need to import people because everyone's into themselves. And actually, as a side, I wrote a comment which is about a future where everybody lives forever. Would you really want to share your money, your resources, your love, your time with kids if it was just you and them in a life raft? Perhaps not. So we have to keep in mind that as we go forward with this immortality and longevity, that it really creates an issue for survival of the species. What's the basic advice to women who are going through baby making? Well, as many of you know, I trained as an OBGYN and practiced that for 14 years before morphing into anti-aging. So anybody over 35 who's been trying 6 months to conceive needs an infertility evaluation, and that can consist of course, a semen analysis up to 30-40% if it's the guy's fault. If you've had a history of tubal damage or disease, then a hysterosalpingogram to see if the tubes are open is a good start. And then you can also test the ovarian reserve, see how much is left in the fridge, how many eggs are left still good in the fridge, and that can be done with a couple of different tests. Women over 40 should pretty much give up. They should consider IVF, which is not really giving up. It's controlled hyperstimulation. So, and then they take the embryos in a test tube, the so-called test tube baby, and they transfer them back into the uterus. And so the intermediate step would be just controlled hyperstimulation, taking these gonadotropins, making a bunch of eggs, feeling crappy, and then having the husband or the doctor inseminate. But if that doesn't work in one or two cycles, you know, it's several thousand a cycle, probably better just to go straight to IVF, which is taking out the eggs, meeting the sperm in a dish, and then transferring them back. So it's a subtle difference. The woman should be informed that the risk of spontaneous miscarriage, like chromosome abnormalities, Down syndrome, will increase, as will pregnancy complications such as high blood pressure, diabetes, etc. What is an egg? So, you know, it kind of amazes me that plants and animals, all eukaryotes pretty much, well, fungi are different, but we have eggs and sperm, so your little tree is making sperm, and that's why a lot of people get the allergies during the spring, because it's all male trees. You know, the city fathers don't want a bunch of fruit on the ground rotting, So they plant male trees, and the male trees are sending out their sperm to try and hook up with female trees. Just something that's fun to think about. So what's an oogonium, or plural oogonia? These are egg stem cells. So like other cells in the body that we've talked about, eggs come from stem cells. And what is a stem cell? Stem cell is an asymmetrically dividing immortal cell. What does that mean? So you have a master copy, which will make two daughters. One daughter is the same similar master copy, and the other is more differentiated. So when you're a fetus, a female fetus, you're making these oogonia in an asymmetric fashion. And you come out with maybe 600,000 at max in the second or third trimester, and then that's all you're endowed with for the rest of your life. The oocyte is the egg per se, and it's sitting there arrested until, you know, you start menstruating as a teenager, or until you decide to have a baby once you become senior vice president at age 39. And it sits in this suspended animation called dictyate. So basically you're endowed with all the eggs you're going to have by about 20 weeks, and they sit there in the fridge until they thaw out. And so the nobody really knows, which makes my research and presentation easy, because nobody understands this process at all. Nobody understands whether, you know, they're aging in there, they're frozen, whether they're being renewed. So we'll just glance, or we'll just skip right over that. On the lower right is what we're talking about here. Then one cell will become four. So the one primary oocyte will divide, and it'll send off a smaller, just tiny little, like little nothing of a cell, because it's trying to hoard its cytoplasm, all the resources that it needs, the egg being the largest cell of the body. And it does that a second time in meiosis two, and then you get three of these useless little redhead stepchildren and one big old mama egg. So that's what we're looking at. We're looking at dividing twice, and of course the chromosome number, or the ploidy, divides, so you can have half a human and meet up with that that Prince Charming half a sperm and create a new human. So the eggs are in the fridge until you're ready to ovulate, and then they get recruited in a process that we won't describe, but suffice it to say that the second phase, the second division, occurs when things are really getting going, and just before fertilization. This is a lovely little chart. Looks like a ski slope, an intermediate or advanced ski slope. So if you have 100% of your eggs at birth, you roll out to about 15 years old. Again, maximal fertility. You only have half left, which would be alarming and seem elicit an emotional reaction from many women, I'm sure, above the age of 30. But let's go down to 30. At 30, 31, you only have about 10% of your eggs left. I venture a guess that if you were to ask the woman on the street, she would not pull these numbers out of a hat. And look, when we get past 40, it's pretty dismal. In fact, unethical, really, to take money from people to stimulate their ovaries and do IVF over the age of 42, and that's a standard in that field of practice. How does IVF embryo transfer work? So what will happen is the husband will inject the wife, usually, with these gonadotropins, FSH and LH, and then the eggs will get super excited. It's an unbridled accelerator. So in a normal woman without polycystic ovary, she will ovulate perhaps instead of one dominant follicle, which the system is rigged to make, she'll make, you know, 5 to 10. And with the transvaginal ultrasound and a loaded needle, you go into the vaginal cul-de-sac, and it's very safe, actually. I always used to think when we did this and watched this that you'd be puncturing bowel and stuff, but not so. You go through the cul-de-sac between the rectum and the bowl of the pelvis, and you just puncture these eggs, and you suck them right out, and so you got 5 to 8 eggs in this tube. You introduce the sperm, and these days male fertility has really simplified with the advent of ICSI, or intracytoplasmic sperm injection. So even people who've had vasectomies or severe disease, you really don't need much of a sperm. You certainly don't need the 20 million that are gleefully expressed during intercourse. You only need one little sperm head, and you can intracytoplasmically inject it into that loving mama sperm. And so the egg starts dividing in the dish, and they halt it, and they freeze it, and then someday you might get that transferred back. And what's shown on the right is that, well, it's just injecting through the cervix into the uterus. That's IVF embryo transfer. So what's the ugly truth? The ugly truth, unless you get paid to do this, and when I did my training at Beth Israel, these guys own buildings and planes, so, you know, it's pretty lucrative. And the great thing about Massachusetts was that it was mandated that all insurance companies had to pay for at least two cycles of IVF embryo transfer. So there was a lot we saw there, and they even had us manage the cycles and manage the complications, so that was fun to do. But it's pretty ugly when you really think about it. When you look at the top outlines thing, this is from national data from surveillance that's done, I think, voluntarily. But this is all best clinics combined in the states. So when you look at the cycles, meaning injection with gonadotropins, if you're younger than 35, you're in good shape, 41%, which is, you know, you'd think it would be automatic, but that's, you know, best case scenario. Of course, as we get older in our late 30s, it drops into the 20s. 40 to 42, it's only 12%. Above 42, it's 4%, identical to the natural rate of conception, although that could be misleading because, you know, it's all comers, so to speak. But it's pretty dismal, and it is, frankly, in the field, unethical to take $5,000 from a woman at the age of 42 for that dismal a prognosis. Next down the line, the numbers change. If you talk about just retrieval, so a woman had hyperstimulation, you didn't have to abort the cycle because of overstimulation, then you're looking at, again, only about a 5% live birth rate. And the live birth rate is the take-home baby rate, and of course that factors in the risk of spontaneous abortion or miscarriage. When you talk about transferring into the uterus, that means past the egg, past the fertilization, into the uterus, it's 6%. And if you're talking about just popping one good egg in there, it's only 0.5%, 1 in 200 chance of taking home a baby after age 42. So, of course, the standard practice is an average of 3 embryos transferred. What happens when you transfer 3? Well, luckily, or, you know, in point of fact, they're so bad at that point, and we're talking about non-donor eggs, not like your college grad helping you get pregnant. This is your old egg, as insensitive as that sounds. You only have a 10% twinning rate and a 1% triplet rate. So here's a nice little study. Again, Maria Blasco is, you know, she's the alpha and the omega of this field. And so she has a very promiscuous and curious mind. And back in 2005, she did a study on telomere length and embryo fragmentation. And it's a small, you know, study, observational in nature, yet she found that when you had the shorter telomeres in the eggs, this would predict fragmentation or a lack of viability and destruction in these pre-implantation embryos. So I actually tried to pitch the life length, the shortest telomere test, to my old teacher at Boston IVF, but I think it was a little ahead of their time, so they didn't run with it. But I think this will be, in terms of PGD or pre-implantation genetic diagnosis and prognostication, a useful tool in about a decade. So this study, again by Blasco, this is predates it in 2002, she did studies genetically manipulating mice, sperm, and egg, causing them to be null in terms of their telomerase activity. And she found that as the telomere shortened, both the shortened eggs and sperm could contribute to poor fertilization. So critically short telomeres, as in every organ system, appears to be a bad prognosticator. This study in 2007, again, Blasco, she's like Moriarty, she shows up everywhere here. She looked at telomere lengthening in early development. It's long been known that there's not just one way to elongate telomeres. We have the telomerase reverse transcriptase, which lengthens the ends in stem cells. We have ALT, which is alternative lengthening of telomeres. And that's long been known in cancer cells. You get a crossover recombination, so you start, you know, crossing over and lengthening that way in big chunks of telomere length. So ALT is called alternative lengthening of telomeres. And this is a process that occurs actively in the embryo after fertilization and appears to be dictated by the programming of the egg. It's called sister chromatid exchange. This is her experiment from that same study, and what she's saying is that in the embryo, the reason why, you know, your egg might have 6,000, you know, your old guy's sperm might have 10,000, 12,000, but when they get together and they make an embryo, then the pinball machine resets. So even though it's an old egg, it has the wherewithal to artificially lengthen the ends. And this process is illustrated here, where you get the ends adding and multiplying and echoing and lengthening up to the preset magic number, which is about 15,000 at conception. So graphically, I mean, in tab form, or in this table below, you see that the number of sister chromatid exchanges is very high early on in the two-cell stage and the zygote stage. And this is actively, it seems to be how they're multiplying and lengthening. It's absolutely not telomerase-based. It's kind of like seeing yourself in a bathroom mirror and then reflecting that back and forth. Somehow these sisters are lengthening and echoing and lengthening, and they make it to the number and then they stop. So by the time you get the blastocyst stage, a bunch of cells together, it's no longer even taking place. The reset has occurred. So let's talk about the fun stuff. The reason I did this webinar, again, as with everyone, you know, it's the first time someone calls, it's anecdotal. Second time, it's trend, or, you know, cluster maybe. And then 3, 4, 5, you start to think, okay, this is a webinar. And I've known about these cases for a while. In fact, when we first started in 08, one of our patients, a 63-year-old woman, started menstruating and did so for about 6 months, which tells me perhaps some kind of ovarian reserve was retapped. I mean, it sounds kind of crazy, but actually Soledad, the 113-year-old, she actually sprouted about a few hundred black hairs after two pills, two nights. And so that's that tells me that there is a certain kind of quiescence or suspended animation that can be immediately resolved or resuscitated. So over the years, there's probably been 3 or 4 other women well past menopause, years past menopause, who started menstruating again. So that's odd. What's very common in young women is actually acne will surge as the female hormones, the quality of the egg improves. And that might have something to do with the decreased PMS. One of Susie's daughters was stealing her stash for PMS. It's because the quality of the egg is better and perhaps the withdrawal from the progesterone is less. Also, increased libido is a manifestation, possibly because of supertentorial, or, you know, you're just in a better mood and you don't, you want to enjoy life a bit more. So that seems to be a common complaint, men and women. And if you're interested in male sexuality, then see the webinar I did on that. I was going to include a 42-year-old Indian physician who got pregnant, but she didn't want to be involved because she felt it was just anecdotal. But, you know, of course, she'd been married for a long time, never gotten pregnant, and wasn't trying to get pregnant at 41, but nevertheless is having a healthy, apparently healthy baby in about 4 months now. So, again, attribution being what it is, she really didn't think it had anything to do with TA, and the very first thing she did was to stop it because she felt it would be dangerous. There, on the right is a friend of ours, Lonnie, who is a fashion model and very high-strung, hypertension, anxiety. She really never had periods, and it wasn't just a body mass index issue. She, when you're in a tonically high stress level, cortisol, poor sleep, your evolutionary adaptation is this is not the time to get pregnant. And that can occur with ballerinas who are below a certain fat index. So she was really wanting to get pregnant, and came to me in that regard, but also she and her husband were interested in the idea of telomerase activation. And of course, you know, cut to the chase, she's pregnant and I think due in a couple of months. But the nice thing is just how blissful she is talking to her. She was very anxious before, and now she is happy as can be. And certainly a second trimester can be a time of extreme euphoria, but to talk to her now, you just can hear the joy and the hope. And luckily, she hasn't had a significant hypertension problem, and so she's very much looking forward. The last case, which we'll really bring it home, is an Austrian psychologist named Nina, who has about, I would say, a 10-month-old now. And so a couple of years ago, she started for a year and got pregnant. And we'll listen to what she has to say. But she really is the classic infertility person. Healthy, maybe to a fault, yoga instructor, less than 100 pounds, eating healthy, probably raw food, and high anxiety. She's a high empath, so she treats people's mental problems. But again, as she says, just because you know what the problem is doesn't mean you can treat yourself. So very high, tonically high stress, really had no periods for 2 years. And then when she started going on a TA, she started cycling like every other month, But the regular menses, the melimina or the PMS feelings you get prior to ovulation, menstruation, which would be breast tenderness, food cravings, moodiness, those never occurred throughout her adult life. And so she was in this category of women that are just not able to conceive for that reason. And then she went through the Clomid, which is pills to hyperstimulate the ovary, which is your first line. And then she went through the hyperstimulation, which is husband injecting and intrauterine insemination, which did get her pregnant. But then she did embryo transfer, and all these things were unfortunately not successful. And, you know, she had given up for a long 5-6 years. And she got pregnant, and very tough pregnancy. And I think you'll hear something that comes out in the future seizure webinar I'll do. You know, she was very worried about birth defects, so she stopped it right away. But up until 8 weeks, and the 7th and 8th week can be difficult, actually. She was perfect. She stopped it, and then she plunged into the depths of, you know, nausea, depression, sleep problems, which plagued her throughout the pregnancy and in the postpartum time as well. So she's right now 10 months out, really in a very bad way, and she's going to restart just for herself, the TA, because it did help her so much. So let's listen to her classic history of infertility.
Yes.
Okay. So how are you? How many weeks are you?
I still have one more month. Then it's, I hope, finished. No, I mean, I was really very surprised that I got pregnant, because I tried for like 4 years, and I had 2 miscarriages before. And I, you know, after, when you have 2 miscarriages, you become like hysterical and you become very nervous. And I wasn't thinking about having children anymore. It was like, okay, it shouldn't be, you know. I mean, I was very unhappy with it, but I didn't want to go through this whole, you know, taking hormones and so again.
Did you do Clomid pills, Clomiphene, or did you do injections?
No, first I tried Clomiphene, uh-huh. But it didn't work. And then I took, I don't know how it's called in America.
Right, they're injections.
Yes, Menopur. It was called Menopur. It's, you have to make injections every day, then you have for 2 weeks, and then for 2 weeks you have to take, you know, the other hormone. Mm-hmm. You know, I'm very slim. I only have 86 pounds, and I was always like that. So I was always feeling terrible with the hormones, because I was so tired and I was so sick. And then I got pregnant the first time.
So you did ovulate on it, right? You did make eggs. You ovulated.
Yes.
And did that, they do? Yeah. Was it intrauterine insemination or just natural?
No, the first time they didn't do anything. The first time was just, you know, I knew when it was time to, when it was the right time, mm-hmm. you know, for having sex. And the first time I got pregnant immediately. Mm-hmm. But then in the 10th week, I got, how do you call it?
Miscarriage.
Yes, I miscarried. You know, I like when you blood.
Yeah, bleeding.
I had bleeding, and I had a miscarriage. And then
large was the fetus? Like 6 weeks, 7 weeks?
It was too small. They told me it was too small.
I'm surprised they didn't do an ultrasound early to know that it had stopped growing.
I did. But the doctor, I changed doctor now. The doctor said, yeah, it's smaller than it should be, but that's no problem.
Just wait and see. But they watched it for a long time, though. If you waited 10 weeks.
Yeah, I don't know why.
How old were you then, at the first time?
I was young. I was 32.
Oh, my gosh. So you've been married how long?
Yeah.
How long have you been married?
Now 10 years.
So you were married at 32?
No. 31, 32, I think. Beginning of 32, yes.
And how old are you now?
Now I'm 42.
Oh, good. So you've been married 10 years, same guy.
Yes, same guy. Yeah. But, you know, they told me with 42, the possibility of getting pregnant is nearly, I think, 1%. Or it's
small.
Yeah. It's very small. And they told me that because if you read all the magazines in America, you know, all the stars, they get pregnant with 43.
Mm-hmm.
And my doctor, he told me that it's nearly, you know, that without, that in most cases, it's not their own egg.
Yeah,
you know,
donor
what
egg.
I mean?
Yeah, of course, it's
donor
egg. Yeah, donor
egg, because with 43, it's so difficult to get pregnant. I don't know if it's why.
That's true. Yeah, of course that's true. So you did, pardon me, you did the IVF one time at age 32, miscarried, and then when was the second
and
time
then,
you?
No, and yeah. then, no, the first time I didn't do the IVF.
Just
the
natural.
The first time, I just, you know, I just took the hormones to ovulate. And the second time I was 38,
mm-hmm.
I did the IVF, and that was really terrible for me because the first time with 32, I only took not so much hormones, you know, just one injection a day.
Yeah.
But the second time with the IVF, I had to take 4 ampoules for the injections every day.
Right. 4 amps.
And that was
That makes you a little uncomfortable. Yeah.
Yeah.
And so they gave you the HCG injection too?
Yes.
You must have felt really kind of swollen and tired. And
it was terrible. I was always, you know, always tired. I couldn't nearly work because I always had to be very careful that I don't fall asleep because I was so tired. I had a stomach like I was in fifth month, you know, it was so swollen and bloated.
Yeah.
It was really terrible.
But you did get ovulate, and you had how many embryos were they made?
Two.
Two? Just two?
Yeah.
Was the quality okay?
I don't know now, you know.
So they put put both of them back in then?
Yeah, they put both in, but I lost it like, I don't know, I think four weeks.
Very early.
Yeah.
So it's probably
very early.
And you were done at that point, even though you've been married, what, 6-7 years?
Yeah, but it was for our marriage, it was a point where we, you know, it was difficult. We nearly separated. We nearly got a divorce because I got depressed.
Of course.
And it was really hard for me. Difficult for me.
Well, so now let's fast forward. So you started taking TA about a year ago or so? Is that right?
I started what?
Taking the TA65 about a year ago?
Yes, about a year ago, yes.
And did you notice your periods were regularizing?
No.
Still irregular?
It was not every month, but like every second month, you know?
And before that, like when you were 40 or 39, was it still irregular?
It was, I didn't have my period for like 2 years.
Yeah.
So it was extremely irregular.
TA at least brought it back once in a while. You were ovulating every other month.
And the best thing, I told you, I have I have an extremely bad sleep. And with the TR, my sleep got so much better. That was the main improvement which I realized, you know.
Yeah.
And then the really mysterious that I got pregnant because I didn't take any hormones. I didn't do anything, you know.
So when the sleep got better, your mood and your quality of life improved a bit.
Yeah. Sure. Sure.
And then,
because you know,
when did you decide to have sex with your husband again? I thought you guys weren't that active anymore.
Yeah, about 2 months after taking the TR.
You got your libido back. That's good.
Yeah, no, really. Not funny, but that was the truth, you know. Yeah, great. I mean, it's really strange. I don't know what's in the TR, but it really works in every kind of way.
That's so funny. So you would say, you know, you do a lot for your patients. You're a professional woman. You're a yoga teacher, and you.
Yeah, I do too much. Yeah. I do too much. Yeah,
but
I know that.
Somehow the whole having sex with your husband thing fell by the wayside, huh? The kind of.
Yeah, I didn't have the energy anymore because, you know, I came home and I was like, cool. I just want to sit down, watch television, and be on my own, you know?
Right, but your libido came back, so you started ovulating. And
yeah.
Then when did you get pregnant? Was it the summer?
No, it was, September.
That's so great. I remember that call.
September.
How fun.
Yeah.
And so were you...
It was really, you know, it was so strange because I remember I was on holiday with my mom, uh-huh. And my breasts, they were so hurt. They hurt so much,
right,
you
they're
know?
Sore and swollen, yeah.
Yeah, and I was not thinking about being pregnant, you know, and I was saying to my mom, it's so strange, I feel so weird and everything, you know. And then I took this test, and I couldn't believe it, you know. It was...
You're used to going many months without your period, right? So.
Yeah, I know.
So you didn't have your period, and we were probably, what, about 8 weeks when you found out? 8 weeks pregnant?
Yeah, I think so, 8 or...
Yeah, the baby was about six weeks size.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
So that's great. So then you stopped taking the TA?
Yeah, and then it got bad. I don't know if it's normal, but the first 3 months were really terrible. I was always sick. I was extremely tired.
Up until 8 weeks when you were on vacation with your mom?
I was good.
Did you feel nauseated and everything?
No.
You felt good. Okay, sleeping good, yeah. Not tired.
Yeah, I was good.
You weren't taking a lot of naps or being tired or anything? You were okay?
No, I was okay.
Okay, we're back. So that was really great, and what a wonderful lady she is, and just a real inspiring. She's gonna send us a picture. Hopefully, she can get her act together. A picture of her with her baby. So looking forward to that. All right. Well, that's the presentation. Just in summation, you know, it ain't good. Once you hit your 30s, it ain't good. So if you have questions, call in. I'd like to address Brendan's question. Brendan asks, time of activation. TA65 is active for how long? And once the telomerase is activated, how long does it stay activated? Finally, once telomeres are added, how long do they persist? If you watch the webinar I did called How Does TA65 Work, you will see that it appears to increase transcription of the telomerase gene. And so in the presence of a reverse, RNA component, the stem cells will be excited. I've seen the data, and it's kind of bimodal, and the pharmacokinetics are not that predictable. But my best gestalt is 14 hours. Yeah, clinically, that seems to be the case. Although some of the mice study shows that it persists over time, but my best guess is it's active for about 14 hours, which is why I have people take it before sleep. Of course, the easier question to answer is once they're added, how long do they persist? And they persist indefinitely because telomere length is DNA, and DNA is passed on to the next generation, so it actually is physically lengthened, and there's no mechanism for it to erode faster other than oxidative stress or what have you. Second question was, TA apparently activates telomerase in the liver by 12 times. How about the brain, the heart, and the lung? Yet there are other bars in the histogram for that, and not as much. But again, you have to take all this with a grain of salt. It's a very specific effect that the TA has. It really activates only about 8 genes. And so it really is a panacea in the best form of the word. It really just heals whatever you need healing. It goes everywhere, even to the non-stem cells, but the stem cells have the wherewithal to unlock the increased number, or that I have the key to unlock the increased number of locks that occur for that 14 hours. So again, I would encourage, how does TA65 work, and TA frequently asked questions. Okay, good question. Anybody else have a question? All right, well, it's been really fun. Thanks, everybody, for your loyal attendance. So we'll be giving a talk to 1,200 doctors tomorrow on the stem cell theory of aging. And then back next week, hopefully I can squeeze out our raffle for Ray. Are you enjoying the TA, sir? You sleeping well? Are you living long and prospering? At first, but life is stressful. Yeah, see, that's the thing. I got an email from a gentleman this morning. He said he's having intense dreams and waking up at 4. And so you have to overpower that by resetting the agenda. You have to, when you wake up at 4 with the anxiety dream, you have to consciously, actively, aggressively choose what aspect of that you want to focus on, what aspect of gratitude and positive visualization and problem solving, and then it'll be better. If you become passive and anxious and worried, then you will descend back into a nightmare. Yeah, isn't that interesting? The dreams are awesome the first night, lucid. It's because the experience of dream consciousness is such so much richer. And you actually have qualia, which is a technical term which appears in the book. Qualia is a state of mind. You have qualia that are just much more vivid. And so that's really interesting, that it's not just like a tunnel vision. And for more information on that, see the webinar on dreams and dreaming that I did. All right, everybody. Happy New Year. Happy holidays. And talk to you soon. Okay. Thanks, everybody. Aloha. Thanks. Bye.